Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of Hashtag Clockedin with me, your host, Jordan Edwards. I'm thrilled to have you tune in as we dive into the dynamic world of productivity, success, and stories of incredible individuals who've mastered the art of getting things done. Whether you're commuting, hitting the gym, or just relaxing at home, this podcast is the go-to source for inspiration and actionable tips to level up your productivity game. I'm on a mission to unravel the secrets of those who seem to effortlessly manage their time and achieve their goals. So if you're ready to clock in and unlock your full potential, you're in the right place. We've got a lineup of amazing guests, industry experts, and thought leaders who will share their insights and strategies to help us crush your to-do list and make the most out of every moment. Get ready to get inspired, motivated, and equipped with the tools you need to supercharge your productivity. This is Hashtag Clocked In with Jordan Edwards. Let's dive in. What's up? It's Clocked In with Jordan Edwards here.
Hey, what's going on, guys? We got a special guest today. We got Christyl Oflaherty. She's an NFT artist and a creative director. So the reason I wanted to have Christyl on today is because it's a major topic. Everyone's talking about it, NFTs and the metaverse and everything in between. So Christyl, how are you doing today?
I'm doing wonderful. How are you?
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah, we're excited to have you on the Clocked In podcast. So Christyl, tell us a little bit. How did you get into NFTs? This feels like it came so fast. Feels like it's still coming fast. Most people might not even know what NFTs are.
Yeah, absolutely. NFTs are, it's big right now and it's not going anywhere. It's actually something that people think like, you'll see a lot of memes right now. NFTs are dead. Oh, might be nothing. You know, there's a lot of memes about that, but it's very early on still. And it's not late at all. It's prime time to jump into NFTs. I started with NFTs back in February and of last year. And I actually have kind of watched them a little bit on the sidelines. I saw things like CryptoKitties. I saw things kind of like people doing, like, what is this weird thing? You know, so I have a son who is 21, so he was always gaming. And, you know, lo and behold, I did not know that over the last several years, all those Steam cards I was buying him, he was actually buying attributes in the game world and with them, you know, and it's actually set him up quite well right now for, you know, what was then his future. So it was during lockdown, during COVID, of course, that we, all found Clubhouse. And when Clubhouse started coming online and everyone was like, wow, now we can talk to people. Wow. There's a portal into the world where we can actually connect again. And it was a big deal for a lot of people that tool.
Just real quick, Clubhouse.
Yes.
It's a social audio app that goes on your phone and you're able to connect with a lot of different people.
Correct.
And there was these rooms and it got really big and it still is big. And it allows people to interconnect without having to do the video, the Zoom, etc. And it allows you to meet a lot of new people. I just wanted to preface that for the audience.
Yes. It was a brand new platform that allowed people to connect in essentially a metaverse. We were connecting via voice only. We could not see each other. We could not touch each other. We could not show each other images. It was all in here. It was all voice through a digital technology. So essentially it was a form of a metaverse that springboarded this whole thing called Clubhouse. And while it's not a metaverse because it's not a digital visual asset, it's, you know, it's not a platform for that essentially, but it was definitely a start place. And it later became rapidly, might I add you, what a lot of people call NFT University. Because when I first joined Clubhouse, there was one Clubhouse room for NFTs. And it was...
Sorry, because I know a lot of people don't know what NFTs are. What's an NFT?
Oh, yes.
Non-fungible token. What does that mean?
Absolutely. Let's go there. So an NFT, a non-fungible token, it's a digital asset that is attached to a unique identified contract address into the blockchain. And it is a way that it gives a piece of art, a song, a writing, a photograph, anything essentially that you can digitize and put online. It could be a book. It could be anything that you can dream up, you can upload into a digital presence onto a computer. And then you attach your digital unique identifying address to it. And it is, in general, the biggest one is it's attached with Ethereum, although there are many different coins and currencies that can be attached, like Polygon and Solana. I mean, there's so many different things that are attaching to them. And they become essentially an asset for you because they develop worth over time. As the prices of that coin or that currency goes up, so does the value of your NFT. So, it's similar to in the olden days, if you were to buy, say, a Mona Lisa painting, of course you wouldn't buy the Mona Lisa, but say you could buy the Mona Lisa and you're like, wow, I've bought this for this, say $1 million, let's say hypothetically, that was like a really cheap deal, right? And so, but you're like, wow, I have this. I'm not going to hang it in my house because it's not safe, A. But I need to go pay someone else to store it for me and curate it, so to speak. And so I might go to Christie's and say, hey, I bought this for $1 million, but I'm going to pay you another $1 million to sit and house this and hold it for me, keep it safe as it grows in value over time. And during that time period, you might say, I might want to sell this now, but now the value has gone up and now I can sell it for even more. And so, when you do sell that, everybody gets a percentage, of course. And that's similar to NFTs. So I would suggest to anyone who wants to really know about what an NFT is and how it works, there is a website called OpenSea.nft, and you can actually just Google the NFT Bible, and it will tell you everything you want to know about NFTs, all the details. There's so many resources now that weren't even here just 6 months ago that you can go in and learn. And take a deep dive, go down the rabbit hole, and you will be really excited that you did. And you might just actually get the bug and not be able to stop. And then you might be excited about that too. So it's very liberating. The whole space is really liberated and set free a lot of people and put everyone into a new playing field in living.
Awesome. Yeah, for sure. And so for you, so this whole experience, so we get back to where you were at, NFT University. What happened there? I wasn't a part of that. I found out about NFTs a little bit later on. But tell us what happened there and how you finally made the jump and started creating NFTs and getting into that space.
Well, okay, so I was in these chat rooms and we were talking to each other all about, like, literally opening our clubhouses and going, okay, I'm online, where are you at? And we were guiding each other and helping each other along the way to learn, how do I even mint one? How do I do it? Or, how much does it cost to get started? And, so we all really supported and lifted one another up, which is huge in this space. This is the artist revolution, is what it's been called. And meaning that it is all about lifting up and empowering other artists, which is a different world than what the business world has been. It's always been, the stronger, the better, cutthroat business ethics. And this is business, but it is I see you. I will lift you up higher. And therefore, oh, I'm going to go lift that person up higher. Everybody's winning because that is what is happening, which is a new paradigm in the business world in itself. But back to your question, with Clubhouse, how did I get started in it? And that I learned from all of my friends and connections on Clubhouse. I actually, my first minting experience was with Jen Stein. I called her. She's an artist in LA. And she's like, just call my phone. I'll walk you through it. And I did it the first one. And that was really exciting. And then I learned about different platforms. And then I got an invite on Foundation NFTs. There's many different platforms. And some of them you have to be invited to by another artist because they want it to be really valued space. So it's not just anyone can jump in. They don't want bots jumping in. So it's sort of a trust system. There's things like Super Rare where you apply and you go, here's my art. Here's what I've done with it. Here's why it's cool. And they go, yes, we'll take you in and then we'll showcase you. And so that a lot of people have done that. And so my first, what I call Genesis piece was on Foundation and it was called Tangerine Dream. And that was my first sale. So that was really exciting. So.
Incredible. And how much did this, I have two questions. How much did it sell for? One. And then my second question is, what artists are getting into this? Like, how did this happen? You know what I mean? Because it's digital art. Like, were people doing digital art before? Like, what was your past? How did it all work?
Well, I can tell you how I first got into crypto. And that was, for me, really, and a really important piece of how I found such grand interest in all of this. It was in 2019, I had a business entrepreneur come to me and say, you got to be a part of this crypto thing. All you do is you buy this much Ethereum and then you have to sign up for advertising and then you have to onboard all your friends. And I was like, well, okay. But then they gave me their advertising. I'm like, this is such sterile, boring stuff. I go, and they're like, you need to go give this to all your creatives, because it was, during a time where I had a really big network on social media and I had Facebook groups and all these creatives following me. And I'm like, my creatives are not going to attach themselves to this. It's very sterile. It has to have an art concept for them to be interested. And so I started creating all of these art concepts with these really far out, like space women going around, you know, with Ethereums and, you know, things flying around. I'm like, if we did something like this, people might be interested in my realm of creatives. And they're like, no, you have to do this. Well, it turns out it was a pyramid scheme that I was getting into. And I quickly saw it. And I went, I'm out. This is not for me. And I cashed out and I just let all of my Ethereum sit there. Well, I bought the Ethereum early enough that it grew. Who knew? A year later, I looked and lo and behold, it had grown. So I was like, well, okay. And then I kind of started diving into the space of NFTs once all of those things started happening. And I had somebody reach out to me and they said, you know, you should buy this Bored Ape for, it's only $200. And I said, it's too much money.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So that was a thing at the beginning for me.
Yeah. So just to give everyone context to this, you need the Ethereum, which is a cryptocurrency, to purchase NFTs, yes, or it's Solana or whatever cryptocurrency you're using for that NFT. And you use these different wallets to make the purchases. But what Christyl just brought up is the Bored Ape Yacht Club. Is it incorrect to say they're 400,000 right now?
Well, the Bored Apes, and then there is the Bored Ape Yacht Club, which is different.
Yeah.
Two different ones. So one of the reasons that the Bored Apes were so successful, which I'd like to kind of go back a little because when you create an NFT that is unique, you remain the copyright holder forever. You always have the intellectual property, and you are always the rightful owner of that asset. Even though you sell it, you still own the copyright. Meaning if I sell, you know, a picture of this pencil, imaginary pencil right here, I sell this picture to you, you cannot take it and change it and call it yours, because I am the copyright owner. Now, what Bored Apes did, they said, you can buy this picture of the ape and then change it to be your own. We'll give you the copyright. So you go and decorate it and make it fancy and then resell it, which their address and you know, this unique identifier is connected to it. So every time it changed and traveled, it made additional funds. So that's a lot to take in. I'm sorry.
No need to be sorry. Yeah. So basically, if I'm understanding this correctly, the Bored Apes, what they did is they used to retain the ownership. And now these people who purchase are still owners, but now they're able to edit it, and they're not edit it, but make adjustments. Is that something?
What they are is they allowed copyright usage. So they said, with NFTs, you can build in what are called royalties. So on each NFT, you can set the royalty amount from 10 to whatever percentage you suggest that you put in there, depending on which platform that you use. So what they did is they said, here's our Bored Ape. I'm going to sell it to you, and then you can go do whatever you want with it, and then resell it. And then that person will sell it. And then that person will sell it. Every single time it moves, they're getting a royalty. If it was, you know, 10, 15, 20%. So those things were flying like crazy off the, you know, off the digital shelves, so to speak. So
because everyone was getting paid.
Everybody wins.
Yeah.
Everybody won. And everybody's still winning. And now it's, you know, I'm seeing a lot of NFT projects that are what are called generative. So projects that are like, well, I'll show you. So for instance, and let me just plug my friends at the Nifty Castle. Okay.
Yeah.
These are called DBs. Are 1,000 different little demon heckin' spawn babies. They're all the same, but they're generative in the sense that they all look different. They all have different qualities and attributes. Part of their promotion is if you are a DB holder of 4 or more in the beginning, they sent everybody out the skate deck.
That's incredible.
As a promo. So now I've got this highly collectible, wonderful skate deck. And the niftycastle.io, they are wonderful guys. They have done so well. And they are actually in Miami right now. And this is their project So it is it's Gifted and Woboy and Sketchnate created this whole amazing project, and they have been so successful at it. So, but this is what is called the generative project, and you will see a lot of that. So that's the Bored Apes, the DBs, the, you know, Ethereals, and you know, Strawberry, what the F.
a lot of the ones.
Yeah.
I'm seeing, I didn't know the term was generative, but basically it's just Christyl had a skateboard, and it would be like, if I was a generative piece, it would be all pictures of me, some with glasses, some with a mohawk, some with all different types of hair, until you get the 1,000 or 10,000 or whatever amount they choose.
Correct. And, you know, CryptoPunks was one of the first that did that.
Okay. I like this. Yeah. The CryptoPunks are one of the top ones. The Bored Ape Yacht Club, another one.
They're the first ones that really took off. Yeah. Because they did it so long ago. But yeah, so, and then you have other artists who were already very distinguished artists who had grand followings, who are like now jumping into the space and saying, hey, you guys all know me. I make amazing art and I'm going to now digitize it and you can buy it that way. So people are jumping in that way. And I have another one. I can't open it, but you can go online and look at this. It's called Super Buddha. It's probably backwards on the screen.
No, it's straightforward. It's Super Buddha, great. Yeah.
So this is a collectible piece. And you can see this is Super Buddha. And he is, this is an amazing art piece inside. I'm not opening it because it is a highly collectible piece that I received. And so that is something that is, you know, forgive my fashion here. So what you can do is, you know, start looking at your favorite artists, and a lot of people are jumping into this space as well. And there's a lot of success going on. A lot of people who are being successful. I'm seeing probably for the first time people going, I have a rope. I see you. Come on in. You do it too. And it's really changing lives. If you all are able to see anything about Art Basel in Miami, you will see many people, you know, celebrating, you know, showing their cool watches, their cool cars, they're doing things in their lives that they never dreamed they would have the opportunity to. And it is because of NFTs.
Yeah.
It is because they've been empowered. It's because they took leaps of faith. They jumped into these big black voids and just said, I know my feet are going to land because my community has me. And it's working.
Can you give an example of that? I know you threw out a bunch of different ones, but when you're saying people are making it, people are able to do it, is it that the digital artist is now able to, like, the way I learned about it and my concept of understanding it is, if you support someone who's small and maybe they, instead of getting a big radio deal, they end up doing a CD deal that themselves, and they sell 100 CDs to those 100 holders, and that can go up because that might be their Genesis CD, where it's their first time that you have ownership of their music, essentially.
Yeah, for sure.
Instead of selling an album.
So an example would be like the DB's project, the skateboard deck I just showed you. The artist hand drew every single one of those on you know, a digital hand-drawn device, probably maybe a Procreate, or I'm not sure what he used, but this is a kid who, a very young kid, probably in his 20s, who was turned down. He applied to be a sandwich sign maker at Subway Sandwich and was turned down for his art. And,
oh my God.
And he was like a little defeated because, you know, he's working mundane jobs, you know, over-the-counter jobs and places like Subway and things. And now he's, you know, driving around in Miami.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, I'd love to talk and throw numbers out, but I don't know that I'm allowed to do that. But it's been substantial. This space
allowed him
and many others to participate in parts of life that never were dreamed before were possible. Yeah,
it's a lot bigger than most people would imagine. Like, people are making more than some regular job salaries. It's very impressive. Oh,
yeah.
And
yeah,
just to not say a number, but like kind of get a perspective. So we have the NFT thing. What is the talks about the metaverse? You mentioned about it a little bit earlier. So NFTs are, we have not photographs, but it's art, 3D, can be 2D, can go a bunch of different ways. Yeah. We can look on OpenSea.NFT and find the NFT Bible to learn more about that. But what is the metaverse and how do the NFTs connect to that?
Sure.
How does that all work?
So and I think the most popular form of what people recognize readily, it would be Decentraland. which is, you know, you put on your Oculus glasses. You can also do it on your desktop and walk around, and people have built different properties and stations and homes and you name it. You know, it's the like the DJ party for so-and-so who's having their NFT drop party in there.
Yeah.
Like, hey, come in to the, you know, party house at 4. We're all going to be in there. And if you're there, whoever shows up is going to get it airdropped an NFT. So people jump in. People are connecting. They're talking online. They're talking through their voice through the machine. It's a reality that is not physical that allows for the opportunities and networking and connecting experiences that you can do in the physical. But now you can create your own worlds and your own looks, your own fashion. A lot of fashion people are getting involved and creating pieces. Like I could go in and buy a Gucci outfit or a Versace outfit and put it on my bunny avatar if I wanted to.
Yeah.
And I could look fly and I could be strolling through Decentraland and showing up to the DJ party. And you really can become anything you want to become. So it's really liberating and it's fun and it's interesting. And it also can be very dangerous because there are a lot of scammers. So you have, that is a huge piece. I think could be a whole different podcast because that is real as well.
The scamming.
Absolutely. Scammers in Discord, scammers for your NFTs, scammers on Twitter, you name it. They're out there right now posing as, NFT projects,
and the key is this comes down to clicking links, right? Just real quickly as like a disclaimer for most people, that because you don't want someone to get into the NFT land and then get scammed and they're like, I never want to do this again. But they're scamming everywhere. It's just whenever there's an abundance, people try to find a way to get it in the loopholes and get there quick,
right?
But in regard to the metaverse, so are all the NFTs able to go into the metaverse? Is it like some NFTs work that way, some don't? Like,
any NFT can be placed in the metaverse as long as the artist does it or grants permission.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. And then with these different metaverses, do we know? Because I know there's Decentraland, there's Sandbox, there's Upland, there's like 3 or 4 more, mm-hmm. and there's probably new ones coming all the time. Is there any direction on what's going to be the metaverse of choice? Because it's really fascinating seeing all these things come so quickly.
It's just coming even faster than that. So I always try to look with a future set of eyes, and I think, where are we now? What's coming down the pipeline in maybe 2 or 3 years? How do you know what's going to be successful? You really don't know, but you can look and see what's being created and what's in the works and kind of hypothesize what that might look like. And one of the things that I'm interested in right now is I understand that Microsoft Mesh is about to happen, has not dropped yet. It's a big deal. And that's essentially, you know, help me, Obi-Wan, you're my only hope, hologram communications. So like when Princess Leia was sitting there on the table talking to them in Star Wars, that's becoming real. So instead of us on this Zoom right now, I could have you sitting in front of me on a hologram talking to me at a table in the future.
Oh, wow.
In the not so far away future. So. Yeah. There's that is another form of metaverse. Beyond that is Neuralink, which is the Elon Musk project, which operates through the, through the glasses, through the eyes, through the connectors of your brain and your body movement and how to connect to all of those metaverses. So while those are not here yet, they are coming. So as you move through this space at these early, you know, Wild West times, where if you can jump in now and become a part of the framework, you're going to be a part of the whole structure later. This is the time is now. So get in, create yourselves, be fearless, and just go for it. Because, I mean, you're either in it or you're not.
Yeah. So when you say all this stuff, it sounds fascinating. It sounds so far off, but as we're seeing it with Mark Zuckerberg and what some of these guys are doing, they have touch the feel. So does that mean that these people would be like the touch feel glasses, all of that in Decentraland, or that would be in any of these metaverses, or it's whatever kind of works? And I'm not asking you because I know no one knows the answer. I'm just curious what your thoughts on this are.
I think that Zuckerberg is going to make his own land, Meta. He'll make his own form of his own metaverse, because that I'm just guessing that is what he's doing. And I think many others will do the same, and it will become a big linking system of different metaverses, just like we have universes where everything connects.
Yeah. This is fascinating.
Right? Yeah.
So what would be the best way for someone to be get involved? In a very simple...
Just learn about NFTs. I have a whiny dog. Sorry.
Oh, all good.
I would say to, first of all, start by purchasing some Ethereum to get started. Just start there. It's a safe currency. It's popular. And then go into that NFT Bible and read it. And it will teach, or you can go on YouTube, and you know, how to mint an NFT is all over there now. When I first started, there was not one video for it. So, But it's
fascinating.
A lot easier than one might think. The hardest part is learning how to set up your wallet and connecting what's called a MetaMask, which is a third, it's like the middle bridge, so to speak. And it's a different online wallet. So it's, once you understand how to set up your wallets and you do your first NFT minting, that's what it is called. When you upload and attach yourself and your address, your unique identifying address, and put something into the blockchain, that is called minting. So that's it. That's what that means, minting.
So you think people should go out and create their NFTs? Like when you mean the mint?
I think that.
And what would someone mint? What would someone mint? Like,
you can mint anything that you can digitize. You can take a photo, you can take a digital, you can do a drawing, you do a painting, you can do a voice recording, a song, music, anything that you can put and upload into a computer, you can make it into an NFT.
Okay. And then just to get ahead of it before it starts happening. So if I was to take a picture of like the White House and I called that my NFT, I obviously don't own the White House.
Right. So I tell people, you do same rules that you would use on the street as far as copyright goes. Just be ethical, be genuine, and be safe. I would not try to make money off of a photo of an intellectual property
that you do not own,
or a person, even a model, even a person. And that's one thing when I take photos of my I do a lot of photography. I use living human people in my imagery, and then I digitize and composite all these digital aspects around them. But I have to get a release signed by them that gives me the rights to use their image and likeness. And then what I do is I give them a percentage of that sale once it sells.
And that's awesome.
So I'm uplifting everyone involved in the whole creative process that way. So, but same thing, you couldn't just take a person on the street, take a photo and then go and make money off it. It's, you just have to follow the laws. I mean, people do it. It's been done. Yes, it has. Has there been a system implemented yet that goes in and catches and snares all these rights and copyrights? And even with digital assets, so a lot of people will use stock images and they'll download them and create images with them, but unless they're paying for the high-end licensed stock image, it's not a commercial, then it's not there now, but I guarantee you in about 5 years everyone's going to get dinked for all that stuff.
100%. Yeah, 100%. Actually, the first NFT that I minted is this background.
Because own this.
Yeah, I mean, because I wanted the podcast. I wanted it to be cool. So I was playing around on a Saturday morning and I was like, which picture can I upload? And then I thought, what do I actually own? And you know what I mean? There's some pictures you own, some things you don't own. And there's just, it becomes a lot of questions. So yeah, the background to the podcast is what I made an NFT out of.
That's
which
so
was
cool.
Interesting.
I love that.
It was fun.
I love that. Yeah.
It was something a little different. So let's dive into it with you, Christyl. What is it that you are working on in regards to this Golden Goddess collection? I know we talked about it a little bit pre-show, but let's dive into it here. What is it? Do people know about it? Is this your first? What's going on with it?
Yeah, so it's kind of a long story. I'll try to sum up. It's sort of a two-parter. In February of 2020, I did a really big project for Black History Month where we meaning a team and I, went out and we recreated the historical Harriet Tubman and the Underground Railroad. So we did that to honor Harriet Tubman and show visual images of her that were unique, but reflected her story and her mission and her passion for what she did to change history. So we did that project, and I think it was 2 weeks after the world stopped. We had no idea that COVID was coming, that's my dog. We had no idea that COVID was coming. The BLM movement was right around the corner. We had no idea what was happening. So fast forward 1 year later, we were still all being creatives. Like, okay, well, we can't meet indoors. We need to be safe, you know? So we met outside in a park and I said, let's do another, you know, empowering thing for women in Black History Month. And I said, what would you all like to do? And they're like, I don't know. We'd like to do something fantasy-like. I said, well, how about golden goddesses? We will immolate you all, lift you up. I would like you to create which golden goddess you would like to be. Tell me which one. And then I will write a story about, I had them write a story about what that goddess meant or stood for. And then I created the images for it. So now I have minted them. I have 36 of them up right now, and I have them minted on OpenSea. And each one has the model in it, has written a story that is meaningful. It holds depth and weight to them individually, personally, emotionally. And there's a lot of passion in this project. And so those are available to mint. I have not shown them to anybody. They have sat in idle on OpenSea because I have been really involved in other projects over the last couple, 4 months. So now I'm ready to kind of pop them out there. So it is called the Golden Goddess Project. And these are photographs of actual, real, beautiful souled women who just had a whole lot of love for doing this project. And I was really honored to be able to put it all together. So.
I love it. And I'll drop the link in the description of the podcast. But This is something, do you have it? Can you share the screen and show it? Because what we'll do is we have obviously the audio podcast, which we'll be putting out and people are probably listening to it. And then we'll also put this on YouTube just so people can see this Golden Goddess collection. And I'll put the link in the bio when we describe it. But yeah, it's the 6 photos, all unique women. And the cool thing is that Christyl was telling me about, as you just mentioned, is that each time these sell, these women get a piece of that, right?
Yes. So these, there's a percentage that will go to each individual into this. I'll keep the royalties and then they will get the sale. So what I'm trying to do is help women to be empowered. A lot of these, let's see, like for instance, let me see this one right here. This is the goal. Are you able to see my screen?
I can see it, but I appreciate if you just read it.
Sure.
As you're talking, just because so everyone listening can keep
going. Absolutely. So this is called the Golden Goddess Mother of Earth, Grace. And this isn't a woman who, sorry, that's my dog. This is a woman who is an up and coming fashion designer. She started out by using repurposed clothing, and she's starting to dive into actual real fashion designing. So, by, you know, this NFT, this will help her business to be seen, be recognized, and it will assist her financially. She's written a little story. There's a story down here that she wrote herself. And some of them are funny. Some of them are beautiful. Some of them are all the above. So I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, that's awesome. I think it's amazing. And it's cool being able to be on the forefront and kind of seeing what the thought process is going through an artist, what they're going through, where the value is created in this, because that's really the big interest of me is with NFTs, there's so many ways to chop up and cut up the value. Oh, it's absolutely beautiful.
Yeah.
If you're looking, yeah, it's amazing. It's got a lot of different colors. It's very unique. It's three-dimensional, and you're not seeing this with a lot of other NFTs.
Right, right. So, I mean, and for this, well, thank you, first of all. That was very kind of you to say. I appreciate you. This gal right here, she's just has such a beautiful soul about her. And, you know, she's very God-oriented, very connected spiritually, religiously. So we've got the, you know, the white dove above her. She's very involved with nature. And so we just decided to make her all about nature. And we actually shot this outdoors in the forest. And so this was something that we really loved doing.
That's so cool. That's amazing. Yeah. So Christyl, awesome. Thank you for sharing this. I hope everyone goes and checks it out just to understand NFTs a little bit more. And if you want to purchase one, even better. But Christyl, for you, where do you see yourself going? Obviously, NFTs are relatively new. Is this a space that you're going to find yourself in a little bit more often? Or what do you see down the line?
1,000%. I have no plans to go anywhere out of this space. I have finally found a way that I can create differences in people's lives. A lot of artists are interested in generating and being popular and making income from them, which is cool too, because that changes their lives. But what I'm finding is that I can actually use NFTs to make real differences and change in other people's lives. And that is what I think is the power of these NFTs. I'll give you an example. I had a person that I was speaking to on a Clubhouse during lockdown. People were losing their homes left and right because they were not employed. And she went around and she took photos of all of these houses that were in foreclosure. They were losing them. They said she put them on a Clubhouse. She put them out on OpenSea. If you buy these, we can give the money back to the people and they can save their homes. And she saved like 400 people's homes doing that. And she made a difference. And then she got the royalties off of it. So she won a little bit too, but she made a difference, which is the power of how this can work. So if you attach something to your NFTs where you're creating real change and making a difference, I mean, how can that be wrong? How bad?
It's a win-win-win. It's awesome. It's an area where people haven't been able to go before. And that's why I think everyone's excited about it.
Yeah, I'm excited.
I mean, of course, why wouldn't you be? This is amazing. Digital art, just the whole dynamics of what is going to be coming down the line. But Christyl, this has been an amazing conversation. I appreciate you coming on. Now, Christyl, where can people find you? How can they reach you? How can they talk to you?
I'm on Instagram, crystaloflaherty.official. I also have a website. It's my name, crystaloflaherty.com. And you can find my work on OpenSea. I'm also on Foundation NFT. So you can just look up my name on Foundation NFT.
Which awesome.
I could.
Actually, you want to pull it up there? Yeah, just show it real quick.
Pull that up. I don't know if you can still see my crazy screen.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, because we're doing the screen share, where we're just getting to see.
So this is what's called Foundation NFT. It's the Foundation app. You simply do a name search for me there. I come up and this is my page. And you can see that I have some things for sale here. And then I have, this is what I call my Genesis piece. A Genesis piece means it's the first one that you sell. So yeah. This was it right here. This is called Tangerine Dream.
Wow.
And this was my fun one that I sold first. This was bought by 3F Music and he is out of Dubai.
Okay. And
the same man who bought the Charlie Bit My Finger NFT.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and the crazy girlfriend. You can see right here it says 3F Music.
Yeah.
So he's what I like to call a whale. He's a really, helped out a lot of people. But these are all the ones that he has purchased and he owns some pretty big ones. So yeah. I just want to give an example to your audience really quickly because this will kind of blow you away. Let me see if I can get down. It was a little early on, so it's going to be down here low. Hold on. So Disaster Girl. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Oh my God. This was a popular meme.
Yeah.
So this little girl is now grown and she put this on Foundation up for sale. And this is how much she got for it. $800,000.
And that 180 ETH is now worth,
it's now worth this much, 800. Maybe it was only 4 when it sold originally, but now it's worth 800. So wow. It's almost $1 million. So that's NFTs for you right there.
That's a really
amazing thing. Here's an example of a celebrity who's gotten into the space, which she's
800,000.
Yeah, she's actually gotten into, this is Paris Hilton. So she sold pictures of herself. It's not populating, but So.
And that's still $6,000.
Yeah, almost $7,000 for one image. And this is
just her being her.
Yeah. So it's really sky's the limit. Anything you can dream up, anything you can create, anything you can make, it's possible.
I love it.
I think everyone should just give it a try because you have nothing to lose, but maybe gas fees are a real thing. I should mention that. Here, let me get out of this screen share. When you mention NFT, there are what are called gas fees. So every time you click sign, yes, I agree, there's a little miniature fee. Sometimes they're miniature, sometimes they're really big. Sometimes it might be like a $30 fee. Sometimes it might be a $100 fee. And that is dependent on what time you try to mint your NFT. So I suggest to a lot of people to do it in the middle of the night when there's not as much traffic. But anyway.
Yeah, because the gas basically comes from the amount of people trying to utilize the Ethereum chain, which causes you to obviously higher demand. Whoever's going to pay the most is going to get it.
So sometimes I'll go in to do something. I'm like, oh, I'll just wait till gas is lower.
Yeah.
And you can go, you can go online and you can go, it's literally called thegasstation.com to see how much gas is. So.
I love it. Christyl, this has been phenomenal. I appreciate your knowledge. I appreciate you sharing the Golden Goddess with us. This has been pretty amazing. And we will talk again soon. Thank you.
I'm honored. I never dreamed that I would be sitting here either. So it's still just mind blowing. I mean, if you would have told me a year ago I was going to be on a podcast for NFTs, I would have been like, what? Who's time for that? That's what I would have said. And now I have time and know it's happening. And so I'm really grateful and I'm really excited. I'm also really willing to answer questions from anyone who reaches out to me. I'm happy to help. And if I can't help, I most likely know people who can. And so anyone who's interested in NFTs, please reach out to me and I'm here for it. Yeah.
Awesome.
All right.
Thank you for reaching the end of the podcast. For that, we'll give you a complimentary coaching session in the link below with Edwards Consulting. Hope to see you there and have a great day and keep clocking in. Thank you for reaching the end of the podcast. For that, we'll give you a complimentary coaching session in the link below with Edwards Consulting. Hope to see you there and have a great day and keep clocking in.